Cousin Mike?
Kevin Powers.
Daniel.
Actually, I never met this guy before, Gabriel. But together, we're doing a video for the Bloodhound Gang.
That's the first time he said together. Usually he says, I'm making the Bloodhound Gang.
You get it.
Yeah.
Sorry, and now, how did you find me? This is really interesting to me.
I have to be honest, I'm in the music industry right now, and I've always like had interest towards people that do music videos, and I've been a fan of like the Bloodhound Gang for a very long time, and I went like super in depth in the history of the band, like they were a hip hop band, and then they became more alternative, and it kind of reminded me a bit of the Beastie Boys, because there's kind of like a close link between the two bands, because
influence.
Do you mind telling me a bit more about your background and how you became interested in the world of visual arts?
Actually, I started in the business. I kind of worked my way up. You know, my ultimate goal was to be a director. I grew up, I'm in Florida now. I'm actually back in Florida. I didn't go to film school. So I kind of just got a job locally on some movies as a production assistant, and then I made my way out to LA. Now, I do have family ties that have helped me. Right, so I've got family with Republic Records. So if you did your history on the Bloodhound.
Brett's, yes.
Brett's my brother.
Yes.
And my cousins are Monte and Avery Lipman, who, if you know who they are, they've done quite well over the years, but a label called SBK Chrysalis Records, and which became Universal Records. So he and his brother decided to start a label, which was first, it was called Cheese Factory.
Yes.
Cheese Factory Records. Right. You know, and I was actually helping him out back then when I was living with them, helping him with promotions. It was all novelty songs back then. And I'm not sure who came across the Bloodhound Gang first. I don't know if it was Avery or Monty. I think Avery got the tape first. And they got interested.
The Dingleberry Haze.
Yeah, so they signed the band, and they had no money. They didn't have any contacts. And my cousin Monty knew I wanted to eventually direct. Music videos really wasn't my thing. But it was kind of a good match because I think I have a decent sense of humor. I totally get those guys. When I met them,
if he dies, we sell more records. And that's how it works.
That's look at why we back
Nirvana. You know, who else has
Sublime.
Died?
Sublime.
That sells a lot of records.
Blind Melon.
Melon.
Di's been selling a lot of records.
Yeah, lately. Princess Di sold a lot of records.
Mother Teresa is like triple platinum.
We should shoot him. He goes down, we all get rich.
Yeah, true. You want to plot it?
It's in the process.
Done. It's okay, goody.
He shot me, but he just hit my knee. Yeah, thank you.
I tried. In the song Going Nowhere Slow, what's the deal with the but nowhere in New Jersey, that's the only place we don't go.
Is that have you ever been to New Jersey?
No, I've never been to New Jersey.
Try to think of what the equivalent would be for France. I don't know, Belgium maybe?
Belgium.
Like a place that like where everybody kind of smells funny and it's like you would go out of your way to go to not ever.
Okay.
Yeah, we did this video called Mama Say was the first video we did. For like $0. We went to Philadelphia. We just looked around, found all these. In fact, if you're familiar with the video, we shoot outside this like factory. If it's in the background, everyone's kind of dancing. Well, when we were scouting, we kind of like made our way in. It was closed down. And I don't know if you know what asbestos is, but we're in one of the rooms and there was literally a pile of this material. And we're all standing around looking at the place and I'm like, what's this? And someone's like, I think that's asbestos. And we're like, okay, maybe we should shoot outside. So we shot that for nothing. And from there, we went on to shoot the next video, I think the next video was the Firewater Burn.
Oh, and that, in yeah. the, okay.
Yeah. So that's what kind of broke the band, because that got MTV play, you know, and it got me kind of on the map again, because I really wasn't looking to direct, but we did that second video. It got some airplay, and then, yeah, I got signed to a production company. And from there, I just did, you know, a couple dozen videos along the way. Unfortunately, I never made it to that next level. You know, I was doing a lot of work with new artists, you know, like first time videos for zero money. You know, it's like, when am I going to get the big budget? But I got to meet some great people along the way, you know. But, and Jimmy, though, is special because he's a very loyal artist. Like, he didn't have to, you know, use me for, I think I did like 6 to 8 videos.
Yes, it's very impressive. Like, and you went like through different eras of the band, and you could see the progression. That's really interesting.
Yeah. And, you know, and I still, and it's funny because literally yesterday, I don't know if you're familiar with the actor Michael McKean. He is, if you look up his IMDb, he's on a lot of TV shows now, but he used to be part of Laverne and Shirley. Do you remember that show from the 70s with the Fonz? It was Happy Days. Do you remember Happy Days?
Yes, I remember Happy Days, yeah.
At the Fonz, you know, Henry Winkler. Yeah.
Henry Winkler, yes.
That was another big 70s sitcom. And so Michael McKean, and he had a buddy of his. They played two kind of like dumb characters. So their characters were Lenny and Squiggy. Squiggy was the shorter guy with the black hair. In the video, Why Is Everybody Always Picking on Me? We hired him to do a cameo as the psychologist.
Oh, yes. Yes, I remember. Yes.
Got the glasses. He's, you know. So he's kind of like a pop culture icon, you know, from the 70s. And just randomly, Jimmy sent me a text that Michael McKean, who's been in like Better Call Saul, he's been in a lot of current. He's from Spinal Tap. If you're familiar with the movie,
yes, the mockumentary, yeah, yes.
Yeah, he's the blonde guy, David St. Hubbins.
Yes.
Randomly just texted, and he's a funny guy if you follow his Twitter feed. He's got a good sense of humor. He texted the cover of Hooray for Boobies just randomly. Right. And then Jimmy texted him back, and then Henry Winkler, the Fonz, chimed in. So there was this little thread back and forth about the Hooray for Boobies. So I thought that was funny. And then Jimmy had forwarded that to me. So I thought that was kind of coincidental. So yeah, so that's what got me into the whole video world. And then from there, basically, I didn't go to film school. My training was on the sets. And again, my background was assistant directing, which I don't know if you're familiar with production.
You were a second assistant in the House of Yes movies.
Oh yeah.
By Mark Waters.
Yeah. That was one of my first, that was one of my first jobs as a second AD. And then I worked a lot with Saban, the Power Rangers, and the VR Troopers, those Saban production, those kids shows. So I worked a lot with them. And as I was getting on with my first AD credits, that's when the directing happened. So I kind of put the first AD, because that's not something I really wanted to do. But from the directing, I got into the editing, because I was, you know, I was inside the, you know, we were hiring editors. I didn't edit back then. You know, Final Cut was just coming around. It was like introduced, I think, in the late 90s or maybe early 2000s, Final Cut. Everyone was editing on Avids. That was the main nonlinear editing machine. And back then, you know, it was like 60 grand or something. It was something crazy to own an Avid. So, you know, you're not going to have these little home editing suites like everyone has now. I mean, it's crazy. Yeah, very, very envious of the kids today who have even iMovie. But like, you know, Final Cut 10 is $300 now. It's crazy, which is what I edit on. But from being in the editing suite and hiring editors, eventually I just was like, you know what? I got the Final Cut because it was like, you know, a cheaper software at the time. I think it was $1,000 compared to $50,000. And I taught myself to edit, and I started editing because, you know, ultimately I felt like I was, you know, telling these guys, there was a few editors that were great. I didn't have to tell them to do anything. They just had a, you know, they knew what I wanted and they saw my vision. It was great. But from there I became an editor, I suppose. And as far as, you know, when the music videos kind of went away, the editing jobs came. So, and I worked primarily with the record labels because I already had relationships, you know.
The promo videos and electronic press kits.
Yeah.
That's on your website.
Yeah. Yeah. Which I'm currently redoing. Yeah. Because so as that went along, but then now I'm doing some YouTube shows. I kind of like, I'm not, you know, I've kind of branched out. No films. I mean, to edit a film would be a real, well, challenge. And I would welcome that. But, you know, you need to have a more narrative experience, which mine is mostly sizzle reel type. There's the football player, Eli Manning. I don't know if you know Peyton Manning, Eli Manning. So I'm involved with his YouTube show.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I'm on as not the main editor, but I've been cutting a lot of the segments, which is actually fun because I'm a big football fan. American football,
yes. Not soccer.
Not soccer.
Soccer.
I remember when we were doing this video, Universal said, hey, I said, who's shooting the video? And the people at Universal said, Cousin Mike. I said, oh, that sounds pretty good, Cousin Mike.
Where does the name Cousin Mike come from? Because I have a copy of Use Your Fingers on vinyl, and it's mentioned at the end, he wasn't doing squats, but Cousin Mike is our executive producer. Because you're credited as the executive producer on that record. So where does that nickname come from?
So it stems from my relationship with my cousins. So when I first moved out here, you know, when Monte invited me out, he introduced me to Jeff Panzer. Jeff Panzer was the vice president of video production for SPK Records, SPK Christmas. And anyway, so I was a PA for a handful of music videos that they were producing at the time. And I got along with Jeff. Now, Jeff is a character. He's like straight up character. Very funny. Very funny guy. So when Monte introduced me to him and said, hey, this is my cousin. Can you maybe hook him up with a PA job? He looked at me. He was like, Cousin Mike. And he's got a really raspy voice. And so he's really the one that coined the name Cousin Mike, because I ended up actually becoming his assistant for about a year at SPK. And anytime anyone introduced me, it was like, Cousin Mike this. And then when I got to do that first video, I was just going to use Michael Alperowitz, and Jeff and then Monty were like, no, you got to use Cousin Mike. There's McGee. There's, you know, everyone's got a little handle. You got to have a name. I'm like, ah, fine. At that point, I really didn't care. It was like everyone was calling me that anyway. So that's how Cousin Mike came around.
You should be grateful.
They shot the video last Tuesday, and it's airing this Sunday.
Right.
You should be grateful. On in a week.
That's good.
I got very lucky.
You got that's any it. Stars yep. in it so that MTV might pick it up?
You know, there were more videos planned to film for Use Your Fingers, because if you look at the later, like, music videos of the Bloodhound Gang, usually there's like three or four videos. Why was there only one video for Use Your Fingers?
So refresh my memory. Which video was that for Use Your Fingers?
Mama Say.
So Mama Say, right. I think, you know, honestly, I think they just, and I'd have to talk to my brother. Obviously, he was the manager, or Jimmy, because I don't know how quick the One Fierce Beer Coaster came out, right? That's the one that has
I think it was like 96.
Because yeah,
they were dropped by their label, and then they signed to another label, if I remember. They were like I remember a video saying that they were the fastest drop band.
They were dropped for Use Your Finger.
Yes, and then they went to Geffen.
We made up some demos and got an independent record deal and put out a very brilliant record called Dingleberry Haze. From there, we got a record deal with Columbia Records. And I think we were actually the fastest dropped band ever, because we were dropped from Columbia Records in 3 months, even before our record came out. And that was called Use Your Fingers. You can pick that up at any bargain bin.
Okay, so that was probably the reason why. They probably just got dropped, I'm assuming. Drops. Yeah, because again, the very, you know, I think they got signed because of the Mama Say video, you know, because they had something to show the labels. Besides the music, you have a face, you know. It's more of a, you know, it's videos are all for marketing, right? It's to sell the artists, to sell albums.